The Southwest Coast Path is one of the world's best-loved walks. At 630 miles, it's also England's longest national trail.
It's not for the faint-hearted. This can be challenging walking.
But boy, is it worth it! I'm Paul Rose, and I've explored the world.
But although I love the Southwest Coast, I've never actually walked its path. Until now.
In this series, I'll be discovering adventure at every turn.
Wow! We're flying, buddy! How big of a cliff is it?
High enough to make your knees wobble.
I'll be discovering wildlife and wild traditions.
Now that's what you call an entrance.
This is where land and sea collide. It really is the walk of a lifetime. This week I'm heading into a new county, and it's one I can't wait to explore.
This river, which runs right under the coast path here at Marsland Mouth, marks the northern county boundary between Devon on this side and Cornwall over there. For many natives, Cornwall is more than a county. It's a Celtic country. And however you feel about that, it's certainly a singular place with an otherworldly feel, especially the section that's ahead of me, the rugged and mysterious North Cornish coast.
In this episode, I'm going to be exploring the coast path as it skims the Atlantic Ocean from Marsland to Padstow, through the surfing town of Newquay, and right down the heritage Tin Coast, ending at Senan Cove on the Land's End Peninsula. My first stop is Morwenstow, the most northerly parish in Cornwall. I'm here with National Trust Ranger Jeff Cherrington.
Mine's amazing. Can you imagine those people?
Because somewhere around here is their very smallest property.
Here it is.
Well, no wonder I couldn't see it. Look at it. It's tiny and it's half buried in the cliffside.
Look at it. Isn't it great?
Is it all right to go in?
Yeah, you go first.
All right, I'm in. Thank you. Oh, yeah.
Hawker's Hut was built in the 1840s by the Vicar of Morwenstow, Reverend Hawker, from the timbers of shipwrecks.
So what's the story behind this Reverend Hawker?
Reverend Hawker, what an English eccentric. So he used to come out here in his big cassock, sea boots, clay pipe, smoke his opium, writing poetry. And Trelawney, he wrote Trelawney, the Cornish anthem.
And shall Trelawney live, or shall Trelawney die? His 20,000 Cornish men will know the reason why.
But I had no idea it was influenced by drugs.
So inspired by opium. Who'd have thought it?
In the spirit of Hawker, visitors to the hut have been moved to create their own kind of poetry here. It's covered in graffiti.
You don't stop people from doing graffiti in here?
No, not really. I mean, people find their own thing here. You know, it's a lovely thing just to come and read.
Why not? I expect he would have loved it, wouldn't he?
It's a beautiful thing.
It's time to move on. The coast path now takes me across a series of dramatic headlands. Crowned by my next stop, the mighty Tintagel Castle.
Legend has it that this is the birthplace of King Arthur, but Tintagel Castle was actually built 500 years after the real, or dare I say it, fictitious Arthur would have existed. But legend aside, This site has been a stronghold for Cornwall's most powerful rulers since the Dark Ages.
Matt Ward from English Heritage is going to give me the grand tour.
And here we go. Welcome to Tintagel Castle, this is it.
Oh, yes.
And we're now standing in the courtyard of the medieval castle. So this was built 1236 by Earl Richard of Cornwall. And what he wanted to do was build a castle on what he thought was King Arthur's birthplace to make himself look really powerful. It had no strategic value at all. There was no reason to build a castle here apart from the legend of King Arthur.
But did King Arthur really exist?
Do you know what? People have been writing about King Arthur for centuries. And if we walk on, I can show you some of the real history from that period.
I think that's a no. Or maybe a maybe. In the Dark Ages, a bustling community lived in Tintagel, right at the very top of the rocky outcrop. The remains of more than 150 buildings are still here.
Between 450 and 700, Tintagel was a major trading port with the Mediterranean. They were bringing in amphoras full of olive oils and spices, and North Africa, you got this fine red tableware and early glass from southern Spain. So they were bringing it all around the coast from the Mediterranean to Tintagel. But what's interesting for me is the amount of pottery that they found at Tintagel. It makes it one of the most important archaeological sites in Western Europe.
Only around 10% of the site has been excavated. But already, more Mediterranean pottery has been found here than in the whole of Western Europe.
I mean, it is one of the most important archaeological sites in the country for that reason.
According to Matt, there's a sacred spot nearby where these powerful Cornish leaders would have gathered for festivals like Midsummer's Beltane.
On an evening like this, it's not difficult to imagine the scene of Beltane in full swing. People are out of the hut celebrating, drinking wine, fires are burning, wild boar roasting on the spits, and their great leader will be standing right here in this auspicious place, looking out over everything he owned. It must have been quite something.
For a moment, I'm king of the castle. A castle where the real story is every bit as awe-inspiring as its legends. And there's more in the way of Cornish folklore ahead of me as I continue southwest on the path. Padstow is famed for its food, but I'm not here for the haute cuisine.
It's May Day today, and in Padstow that can only mean one thing, the Obby Festival.
Obby is the biggest event in Padstow's festival calendar. The osses are stylized types of horses. There are two, the Blue Oss and the Old Oss. I'm meeting up with supporters of the Old Oss.
So it's a part of our family. It goes passed down from father to son, and that's the way it's been for a long, long time.
What can I do to help? I can't join in, can I?
Just keep out of the way.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, that's me told. It might be a serious business for some, but for the crowd, it's a chance to let it all hang out.
Well, the atmosphere is building now. In a few minutes, this whopping great oss is going to come flying out there, and I understand it comes out with a real burst. So we're all waiting. Great sense of excitement. And we're ready, aren't we, Stanley? We're ready.
As the oss dances, it's taunted and prodded by the teaser.
Now that's what you call an entrance. A bit tribal in a way.
These two head up a procession of dancers and musicians. The osses now work their way towards the country house of Prideaux Place.
Hey,
the Blue Oss is invited to dance by Peter Prideau Brun. His family have lived here for over 400 years.
I'm 71 years old, and I've known it since I was a baby, and it still sends prickles down my back. There's something so wonderful about it. But the Padstonians regard it as being something very, very special to them.
So there is a terrific sense of ownership and pride about the Obby Oss Festival.
Yes, very much so.
It's tradition for Peter himself to take the stage as teaser.
Well, that was great.
Hello. Now, that was a great performance. Tremendous in there. The acoustics are great, the sound is overwhelming, and the whole experience is just tribal, traditional, and very beautiful indeed. So far, North Cornwall has been full of history and tradition. But my next stop is all about future generations. I'm heading to Surf Central, Newquay's Fistral Beach. Newquay's beaches are the most visited in Cornwall, which means that the local lifeguards have really got their work cut out keeping bathers safe. Luckily, there's no shortage of new recruits. These are Newquay Surf Lifesaving Club's nippers. Ash Mann is their trainer.
Gonna love you to get involved with this.
Yes,
but what I've got to get you to do first, as you see behind me, these guys have got little hats on. They're red, yellow and blue. Fantastic. And you're gonna have to wear one of these tonight to be involved.
Sounds great. Oh yeah.
The toggle slips behind the chin and we tighten that one up.
Now this feels good, what do you reckon?
You're looking the part already.
Hey, can I have a go?
It's a go.
Okay.
It's Paul. We're going to get Paul involved and we're going to have an understanding of flags. So we're going to drop Paul right in the middle of the mix. How do we reckon?
In here.
There we go.
All right. Thank you, I'm in.
So what I'd like everyone to do is lay down flat onto their bellies with their hands in front of them. Heels together.
Oh, done. The aim of the game is to get a blue rod. If you don't, you're out.
Got it. I've got it.
Heads down.
Oh no. Ah! No! I didn't get one. Wow. You
guys are so quick. So what does that mean? I'm out.
Are you out as well?
Me too. Well, let's face it. I didn't really stand a chance against this lot.
Well done.
Okay, Paul, so you've experienced the flags. How do you fancy coming with my youth now?
Yep.
And let's go and get wet in the sea and experience a bit of tube or board rescue.
Absolutely, yes, please.
Let's go for it, mate.
In this exercise, I'm going to attempt to rescue a swimmer stranded at sea.
Swimmers, set.
Swimmers are in position.
Wave, everyone.
Time to jump in and bring them back.
Are we happy? Let's go!
It's not as easy as these young lifesavers make it look.
I got it. Come on, everybody. Back to the beach.
In terms of the rescue technique, I don't think you did a bad job for your first go. But you're blowing a little.
I'm blowing a bit. I felt like I needed me fins.
You certainly do.
And me diving gear, you know.
Well done.
It's live, look.
I've had a ball in Newquay. But I'm back on the path and heading south. There are plenty of sandy beaches on this stretch, but few can compete with St Ives. It's a scene often captured on canvas, and I'm here to see how the unique light and alternative spirit of St Ives have attracted so many groundbreaking artists.
Barbara Hepworth came from the cool, grey north, seeking to find herself in Cornwall, and Cornwall in herself.
Barbara Hepworth was one of Britain's greatest sculptors. She lived and worked at Trewin Studios in the centre of town for more than 20 years.
I came actually, accidentally. That is, I came for a holiday and I stayed. But as soon as I got here, I began to realise very, very swiftly why it was there had been artists working here for 75, 80 years.
Her beloved studio has been preserved and is now a museum. Hepworth spearheaded the St Ives School of Art, based at Porthmere Studios, overlooking the beach. It's still very much a hub for local artists, like Hilary Gibson from the Porthmere School of Painting.
Is it true about the light then?
Yes. Even on a dull day, the light here is astonishing. And it is the reason that many artists have gravitated to St Ives. It's almost like looking through rose-tinted glasses.
Well, what are you and the group doing today?
Well, today is Sketch and Stroll.
Sketch and Stroll.
It's something we do through the summer months, come rain or shine. And for artists, really, we like to work outside, so in the elements, like Turner did.
Well, it sounds like a lot of fun. I'd love to have a go.
Well, it just so happens, Paul, that I've actually brought you a sketchbook from the School of Painting and a couple of pencils.
One day, this might be worth a lot of money.
I'm sure it will.
Not sure Hillary's convinced, and with good reason. I'm no artist. But if this vista doesn't bring out the Turner in me, nothing will.
OK, gang. Right, we're going to do a drawing.
Right.
But before we do it, I just wanted to talk to you about Wilhelmina Barnes Graham. This is Eight Lines Porthmere. It has been in the Tate here. And what it is, really, is it's a sort of simplification. Each time a wave has come in, she has drawn that wave in its simplest possible form. And it's when they die that I think they're so beautiful, because look at that one now. It's just going back underneath the next one coming in. And so they're constantly overlapping each other. So our task is Eight Lines Porthmere. So you're looking a bit worried there.
I am. Yes. Terrified, and I've got to draw something
okay.
now.
Drawing is 99% looking.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
99% looking.
Mm.
And 1% putting things on the paper.
Yeah.
Okay.
In the right place. Try and get them overlapping.
Ah, overlapping.
Yeah.
I like
that.
Yeah. Hang
on. That's it. You're done. That's great.
Look at that. That's all right there, isn't it?
Yeah.
Good. You squint a little bit.
Okay, so perhaps I won't quit the day job just yet. But this has been the perfect way to experience the magic of St Ives. It's time to leave those aquamarine waters behind. I'm heading to Cornwall's oldest mining district, the Tin Coast. The engine houses perched along this stretch are some of the most photographed features in Cornwall. But these structures aren't just photo opportunities. They're surface evidence of pioneering submarine mining that extends over a mile out to sea. The coast path brings you to the doorstep of Levant Mine. Like all of Cornwall's tin mines, it's now closed. But its original beam engine is still working. Anthony Power looks after it. Okay, Anthony, we're at the beating heart of the mine.
It is, yes. Yeah, and we're just about ready to get it running.
All right, come on, I'm excited. Oh, it's absolutely beautiful, isn't it?
It is.
In the 1850s, there were up to 60 tin and copper mines along this stretch of Cornish coast. Levant was one of the biggest. Cornwall was one of the beating hearts for the Industrial Revolution.
It was. The steam engines were developed originally to pump water out, and it's that technology which then goes into factories and into steam locomotives. You could argue, I might sometimes, the whole Industrial Revolution starts in Cornwall.
It was a revolution built on hard graft, and I'm about to get an idea of how hard. Heading down into the belly of Levant Mine. How did they go up and down every day for work?
Well, we're standing in the shaft where they did that, and coming down through here from up there to about 550 metres down below, it's
a
single rod worked by a steam engine up the top there. But on that rod, there were steps. So to make your way down, you'd be standing here, and the rod would lift up, and you'd step on. Down you go 12 feet and you step
over.
The next one, and the rod moves up again.
That's
you step onto
clever.
The second. Fantastic.
So they went up and down this thing on the terrific man engine. It's not here now. What are we going to do?
We're going to go down this ladder way, which is just behind us.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a formidable descent. In the mine's heyday, 600 men and boys would have made this journey every day. Well, this is great, Anthony. I'm beginning to get a sense of what it's like underground here. But what was it like for the men that were working?
You're looking at sort of temperatures of 35 to 40 degrees centigrade. And then what you're doing is physically very, very tough. You're hand drilling holes into the rock,
right.
Put your explosive in, fire your charge, and then you go back in and you pick out the valuable stuff.
And then you follow that by climbing all the way back up.
Yes.
Right.
Which, of course, is why the man engine was such a boon, if you like, because at least it took that effort of that climb back up.
But that boon led to one of Cornwall's worst ever mining accidents.
As the day shift were making their way to the surface on the man engine, one of the metal straps that secured the top of the rod to the beam above us broke. The rod swung from side to side. This is with about 100 men on the step. Then part of it broke away below us, and this whole top section, probably about 150 feet of rod, plunged like an arrow 500 feet down the shaft and just crushed everything in its path. 31 men were killed, another 19 seriously injured here.
Levant never fully recovered. Shortly after, tin prices crashed, and in 1931, the mine closed. The conditions the miners endured were grueling, but their legacy is this atmospheric landscape, a centerpiece of the Southwest Coast Path. My walk through North Cornwall is coming to an end. I'm only a stone's throw away from my final stop of this stretch, Sennan Cove on the Land's End Peninsula.
This is Mayen Lookout above Sennan Cove, and over there is Land's End itself. But for me, this is as good a viewpoint from the southwestern tip of Britain as we're ever likely to get. So this is my personal Land's End.
As well as killer views, the cliffs above Sennan offer some of the very best climbing in the southwest.
Yeah, so I've got your helmet here.
Right.
Get that on your head,
thank
please.
You, mate. Yeah, helmet.
The Royal Marines come here every year to train, and today they've invited me to join them.
Be honest?
Yeah.
No. Okay, all ready?
Yeah.
Okay, we've got to go.
Colour Sergeant Mac McMillan is their chief climbing instructor.
Okay, this is the descent route here. It's called Ashcan Gully. It's a very fairly moderate scramble descent. Then we're going to move around the front of the cliff to the actual climb itself.
Mac was shot in the throat while serving in Afghanistan. So he's not the loudest Marine I've ever met, but he is one of the most agile.
All right, so we're coming onto our route somewhere, aren't we? Yeah.
We start here by this block, by the hanging block there, the obvious one.
Oh, yeah, the hanging block.
And we take the line of the right of that sort of block.
Oh, yeah.
And pretty much straight to the top.
It's a big climb. Even Mac struggles.
Did that again?
Not easy to hang around there, is it?
Second time lucky.
What do you reckon, Mac?
Yeah, good.
Mac prepares the anchors for the top rope. That's what will save me if I lose my grip.
That's me, Mac. Woo! Climbing, buddy. Oof. I'm off the ground, Mac. Like a miracle.
It's been over 10 years since I last climbed here, but it's every bit as beautiful and hard going as I remember.
There's nothing very easy about the top either, is there? Terrific climb. Thank you very much, Mac, huh?
Oh, Christ.
You made it look easy.
I don't know about that.
I followed every one of your steps. But look, thank you very much.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm back at Sennan Cove. I really am back. This has always been a very special place to me. And to reconnect to it via rock climbing couldn't be better. And it's the perfect end to my walk in North Cornwall.
Next week on Coastal Path, I'll be exploring South Cornwall, where I'll be taking a leap of faith at the lizard.
Firing the gun!
And having a blast in Falmouth.
Oh, fantastic!
In fact, that's all here tomorrow at 7:30. Next tonight, we visit a land of extremes, Hokkaido in Japan, Earth's enchanted islands. And that's followed at 9 by adventures much farther afield as we begin to explore the planets.